We want to welcome everybody who is here for the first time or joining us. If you're joining us for the first time online, we welcome you. Let's give everybody a big round of applause if they're here for the first time. We're glad you're seeking truth and cutting through the lies. Seek ye truth. There we go. The sign is now up. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. We now have our tongyo mark up. And today at the large sanctuary right here at 3 p.m., we have the movie Armageddon. Yeah. We'll be playing today at 3 p.m. So join us in the main sanctuary for a movie with a powerful message, very powerful message. It was produced by Chuck Norris's son. Yeah, so we like Chuck Norris. He's a real martial artist. He's also a third degree black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He's been training quite a long time. So he's not an idiot. He learned what was real from the beginning, you know. He wasn't one of those martial artists no, that doesn't work. Only my traditional martial arts work. He was an open-minded martial artist for reality, real truth in the martial arts world. So I really appreciate Chuck Norris. Last night was teen night, when 6 p.m. on the first and third Saturdays of each month here at the Sanctuary Church. If you want more info on that, contact Jamal Johnson. And the winner of last night's apologetic speech contest was Shin Gung Moon. And she preached, well, she had a paper and, what is it, presentation? On the flip side of feminism, is that right? Deconstructing feminism. Woo, man. Okay, what was that? Also, we have a sisters breakfast meeting, which will also be the topic of flip side of feminism by the Queen, and that will be in the sanctuary. Time 9:30 a.m. on Tuesday, September 20. So when is that? This is this Tuesday, right? So this Tuesday, 9:30 a.m. September 20 for a sister's breakfast meeting. $3 to $5 to cover the food and expenses. All sisters are invited to come listen, share, listen and hear some words on the flip side of feminism. How to deconstruct feminism, especially when you're being bombarded by it every which angle. Okay, so if you want more information about the teen night, please contact Jamal Johnson. Okay. Next, please. What is this? Oh, okay. Let's watch this video.
I have very much appreciated the chance to hear insights into why the Chungilguk Constitution is written the way it is. I'm inspired that this thought can become substantial on the earth because it has to be first bound on earth before it can be spread to all God's children and kingdom. Tim's insights and understanding of the U.S. Constitution as well as the Chungilguk Constitution have been very helpful. Recommend this class to anyone because it can really inspire to get you closer to God and understand Him in a new and deeper way. I went through a lot of struggles about what was going on in the church. Father has helped me understand that eternal life and love matters more than any other thing in this world, and this is the direction our second king is taking us, building our relationship with God. Wow, the HSU class, Too Busy Not to Pray, was empowering. I am now transitioning from being a prayer worrier to being a prayer warrior. I am very grateful to God and True Father that led me to take this class with Dominique Yegua. It was an awakening moment for me, reminding me of the early days when I joined the Unification Church, how prayer and reading the Word of God was the number one priority in our life of faith, because it enabled one to separate clearly good from evil and connect to God in the second coming of Christ, True Father. I decided to take this class because I wanted to hear Heavenly Father's voice in this struggle time period. But the more class I take, the deeper I go into my personal life. How much closeness do I live with God? I didn't realize many things I struggle about myself without God. I want to be with the living God all the time, every moment of my life. As a unificationist, I have either been fanatically public-minded or extremely self-centered, no middle ground. Now that I am working on becoming a real Christian who takes the gospel seriously, I have noticed an internal shift which is towards a more healthy and personal faith. I learned the value of sincere prayer.
まず夫婦がですね、お父さん、お母さんがお父さんを尊敬して、そういう尊敬して、そういう姿を通して子供たちがだんだんとこう悟っていくような、そういう環境を作ることが、まず夫婦の段階で努力をされることがいいんじゃないかと思います。
애들이커졌기때문에이제아이들이아내아이들이당연히신앙을받을것이다이렇게생각하지마시고요아내가얘들을전도해야된다이렇게생각하셔야돼요
뭐大きく子供たちが大きくなってしまったのでですね子供たちに信仰を強要するのではなく自分が子供たちを伝道しないといけないんだとそのように考えるべきですね
그냥생각을바꾸셔야돼요
考えを変えていただけたらと思います
I felt that we really need this kind of apologetic way of thinking, discussing and arguing. And I think especially younger people need this type of study, because most of them sometimes just follow their parents without questioning, and they may have difficulties when they encounter the culture or ideology which denies God.
In Hyunjin's view, mother is the leader of the brides of Christ.
В понимании Хёнджинима мать является лидером жён Христа.
So she is the top bride of Christ, but she is not the only bride of Christ.
Самая главная жена, то есть высшее положение жены Христа.
But of course, mother is saying.
Конечно, мать говорит.
Different, right?
Она говорит по-другому.
The mother is saying that.
Мать говорит.
She was born sinless.
Что она была рождена уже без греха.
If you think about it, it means that mother did not did not need to meet father. She did.
Тогда мы думаем, что матери не нужно было встречать отца.
So, I think if people look at actually what mother herself is actually saying, they will realize she is creating new theology.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Shina, who made that wonderful video. She made it beautiful. Let's give it up for Shina. Very talented with that production value. Okay, folks, October 30th, 2016, we have the Ancestor Liberation coming up. Ancestors up to 210th generation can be liberated by direct descent on Earth, who is in True Father's lineage. Please submit application. Donation amount is you decide. Special liberation for all children who died before birth as a result of abortion or other circumstances. So for all unborn children throughout history, no application or request is needed. Spiritual and physical life begin at the moment of conception. So that is coming up very, very soon, in nearly a month. And we had many questions about the eight lines of ancestors. So here we are, we have a husband and have his husband's dad and mom. Then we have the dad's dad and mom. And that creates here eight lines, okay? So those are the eight lines, 210 for the husband and then the wife on the other side. Does that make sense? It's easier to visualize it, right, when you see it. It's hard to understand it when Tim tries to explain it to you. It's very hard to understand. But when you now this picture really graphically illustrates the relations, okay? Scheduled for October 29th and 30th. This is Saturday, October 29th, so it starts on Saturday. It will begin with 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., highlights of the OSDP seminar, $40 per person for lunch and dinner. And that will, at 5 o'clock, there will be a holy blessing to return to True Father's authority led by Dr. and Mrs. Panzer. And those are for people who are receiving the blessing before they do the ancestor celebration, okay? And 6 p.m. dinner, so that is starting on Saturday. Then on Sunday, October 30th, 10 a.m. Ancestor Liberation and Blessing. Noon is Luncheon. 2 p.m. will be Holy Blessing by King and Queen in Main Sanctuary. That is primarily for a second gen couple that is coming from Japan. So people who are also getting blessed can also join us there. However, just remember that is after the Ancestor Liberation. So if you need to get blessed before Ancestor Liberation, you'll do it with Dr. Panzer, okay? 3 p.m. will be a gospel-based entertainment, and 5 p.m. dinner time. Then the following day, on Monday, October 31st, we have 8 a.m. Celebration of the 57th Truth Children's Day and 29th day of opening of heaven for the unified world of heaven and earth. So these holy day holidays, we looked at the precedents, and Father commemorated this Children's Day before he passed at 8 o'clock. Usually, remember how we do it at 7? My father allowed it at 8 o'clock, so we will follow that tradition and do it at 8 o'clock, Monday, October 31st. Then from 10:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., there will be a Q&A session with the King and Kukjinim, and there will be a 12:45 p.m. luncheon, okay? So that, of course, as you know, there will be we will have delegations from Asia as well in different countries. So they're, of course, welcome to join and have that Q&A together with us, okay? Monthly seminars on the Divine Principle, when? Third Saturday of each month, where? In a small sanctuary. The fee is $20, including lunch and refreshments. And the next seminar will be 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Saturday, October 15th. Broadcast live, the lecturers are James Bohr, Dr. Panzer, Kerry Williams, and Gideon Rauchi. Okay, so please join us for those on the third Saturday of each month. Weekly Bible study, I Know Nothing About the Bible. When 9:30 to 11 a.m. every Friday, okay, that's the morning, 9:30 to 11 a.m. every Friday now, from September 23rd through December 2nd. Okay, and that will be in the study school room. The fee will be none, and the lecturer will be the queen. She will be teaching her class to a group of young people as well, but everybody's invited to come, right? Okay. So it's a very, very good, class that she has prepared. Freedom Society seminars. On September 15th, we discussed pedophilia amongst the elite. Join us on our next meeting on October 6th. The location is Car Arms Conference Center, Factory, and place will be Lawrence Valley, PA, 7 p.m. Okay? So our next meeting will be October 6th. October 6th. 10 out of 10 dictators prefer unarmed civilians. There it is. There it is right there. That was an amazing night, wasn't it? We got really deep. Wow. Okay. Also, we want to thank Luce and Jonathan for cleaning the front terrace out there in the main sanctuary. Let's give them a big round of applause. Thank you, guys. Good job. Did you guys power wash it? Very nice. Okay, very nice. That's that big machine there. Okay. I'm getting excited. Okay. Registration deadlines to vote in 2016 general election, November 8th. Pennsylvania is October 11th. I just registered right now with Tim. And so it's very easy. You just go to the website and you just fill out like one page. Very, very simple. Make sure you register to vote. Pennsylvania, October 11th, New York, New Jersey, 14th and 18th, okay? Everyone's welcome to lunch. We thank you all for your wonderful potluck dishes and for respecting adults at lunch on Sunday. The kids are respecting the adults. Please do not take food into the small chapel or library. If you're bringing dessert, please make it a healthy one. The food ministry appreciates your help, and let's give it up one time for the food ministry team. We don't forget about you guys. Don't worry, we don't forget about you guys. They're joining us, and we see many of them at the Freedom Society lectures, so we're very happy to see them. Danger, construction area. For your safety, please stay out of the office construction area in the rear area of the church. There's still sharp stuff and stuff like that. So that is still a construction area. So just be careful. And today there will be anointing of Gary and Wanji Ro as Maryland Sanctuary Coordinators. Okay, so they're here with us. Are they here? They're there. So stay with us after service so we can anoint them. And reminded parents of infants 48 months and below, for Sunday school, please use the nursery room or remain in the main service with your child. Please keep an eye on your children, and playing near the road may be dangerous. Let's thank the Sunday school teachers once again before they go and teach the kids. Good job, guys. All right, kids, you get to go with the Sunday school teachers. Enjoy Sunday school. Okay. All right. Kingdom cultivation. Okay. Let's get into our scripture today. And we are going to go into Luke 11 today. And let's get into some word. Luke 11, 14. And we're going to actually go beyond 23 as well. Let's go. Let's read this entire section. 14. One day Jesus cast out a demon from a man who couldn't speak. And when the demon was gone, the man began to speak. The crowds were amazed. But some of them said, "No wonder he can cast out demons. He gets his power from Satan, the prince of demons." Others, trying to test Jesus, demanded that he show them a miraculous sign from heaven to prove his authority. He knew their thoughts, so he said, "Any kingdom divided by civil war is doomed. A family splintered by feuding will fall apart. You say, 'I am empowered by Satan.' But if Satan is divided and fighting against himself, how can his kingdom survive? And if I am empowered by Satan, what about your own exorcists? They cast out demons too, so they will condemn you for what you have said. But if I am casting out demons by the power of God, then the kingdom of God has arrived among you. For when a strong man is fully armed and guards his palace, his possessions are safe. Until someone even stronger attacks and overpowers him, strips him of his weapons, and carries off his belongings. Anyone who isn't with me opposes me, and anyone who isn't working with me is actually working against me." Let's go to 24. When an evil spirit leaves a person, it goes into the desert, searching for rest. But when it finds none, it says, I will return to the person I came from. So it returns and finds that its former home is all swept and in order. Then the spirit finds seven other spirits more evil than itself, and they all enter the person and live there. And so that person is worse off than before. As he was speaking, a woman in the crowd called out, God bless your mother, the womb from which you came and the breasts that nursed you. Jesus replied, but even more blessed are all who hear the word of God and put it into practice. Amen. So that's a very powerful word right there. I just want to jump to a video. Let's cue that video. 힐로이 말고 그 첫 번째 그 딴 비디오. Let's cue this video. Let's watch this video real quick. Okay, there it is. Now that's a video that we didn't produce that. Somebody produced that. But of course, taking the reality that we've been, you know, talking about with the worldwide community for now over, what, year and a half now? Is it a year? 2 years now? Is it a year and a half? Okay, maybe a year and a half. Also, in Korea, we got a report this week of the letter. There's now an anonymous letter written by a, quote, public official in the Family Fed who is now starting to voice their opinions and start saying, you know, mother, you're going off the deep end. Nobody's buying this only begotten daughter stuff. And you know, you've got to get this straight. You know, this is nobody's going to follow this. Everybody was going to leave you. So now you see people even in the in becoming now more emblazoned to stand up against this. Okay, and so that's at the same time that, of course, the Japanese church is collapsing. So as their financial centers are collapsing, and as their illusions of power collapse, of course, they are. We talked about it a couple weeks ago, didn't we? They will be forced to do more and more larger events, et cetera, et cetera. They had a youth event where thousands of kids came. They charged zero for that event. So they did it for free, which means they had to burden all the cost, because doing an expensive event like that with all those stupid light shows and all that is expensive. And then, not only that, they paid the kids $100 each. They now have to pay people to come to their workshops. They're paying people, they're basically bribing young children, come and we'll pay you $100. See that? The illusion is collapsing. And of course, people who go out of that motive to get $100, these are not righteous people. These are people who want a freebie. These are takers. They're not givers. They're not people who build civilization. So they may have a nice little video show of, you know, 1,000 people there or so. But internally, it's rotten, collapsing. Internally, it's dilapidated. What's amazing is that as we stood up strong against the heresy of the Han Mother, and I had to do that. It was part of my duty. It's part of my responsibility. It's part of the trust Father entrusted in me. And I had to overcome all the personal difficulties that come with that issue and stand not in my person, but stand in the position Father gave me. So in that position, I have to, as the, you know, Taishin Jiao Chu Father, I have to stand almost as the judge of the land. So I have to speak clearly, even though it's my own mother. Right? A judge cannot say, well, you're my mom, I'll let you off. You take everybody, you know, you're taking everybody to a pit of hell, and their souls are going to be burning, you know, in torment. So, you know, I can't just say, you're my mom, so you get off the hook. That wouldn't be just, and that wouldn't be good. So in that position, it's not easy, but I had to do what I had to do. I had to speak the truth. And, of course, at that time, nobody understood what was going on. We thought it was just an internal issue. We've now come to understand that this is intimately tied with the macrocosm. Intimately tied with the macrocosm. Whatever happens here, you can see it almost happening on the worldwide stage, even a couple months later, a couple weeks later, happens very quickly. And so after we broke the silence, et cetera, then you see the Trump revolution. As we were getting mocked, Trump's getting mocked. You know, as we're talking about 9/11 and stuff like that, Trump starts talking about 9/11 and stuff like that. It's just insane how the parallels are. And then as we attack and as we stand forth in truth, which is uncomfortable, but as we went to battle Satan, then at the same time, now you see in the global scale, you see Hillary's power is collapsing. The same time the Han Mother's power is collapsing inside, and of course they're trying to lie about, oh, no, it's so wonderful, look at these big events we had. Well, you paid everybody to be there. So not only are you paying the employees, but you're paying the little kids to be there too. great job. That's called North Korea. That's called Iran, okay? These people are not there because they believe and or they are filled with the Holy Spirit. They're there because they get a free buck. Okay? And so that illusion is collapsing. At the same time, you see on the worldwide level, there's a battle between globalism and sovereignty, which is symbolized by Trump versus Hillary. And you see the Hillary campaign just collapsing. It's totally imploding. In the last week, right, remember for the last 2 months, they've been saying anybody who dare questions, even if you're a medical doctor, if you dare question Hillary's health, you are a conspiracy theorist. You are tinfoil hat man. You are crazy. This is what they were doing, right? So they were using fear tactics. Anybody who dare question the health of Hillary Rodham criminal. I mean, Clinton. Right? And so what happens? This week, she's at the 9/11 event, probably the most high-profile event. She's had like half the events that Trump has been having. She's been hiding, she's been wheezing, she's been coughing, and they've said, oh, no, no, she's just got a cold in the middle of summer. You know, oh, there's a heat, there's the heat. And then 9/11, of course, the 9/11 day, she collapsed. She had to leave early the 9/11 event when all the cameras were there. So it was absolutely the worst time for her to have a panic attack and a faint attack or whatever. And they had to pull her out, right? And then, of course, they blamed the DNC, the Democratic people, tried to blame it on the weather. They said it was a oppressive heat wave that did it. It was 74 degrees with no humidity. It was cool. It was one of the coolest days in the summer. And if you're fainting at 74 degrees, you got some major problems to be the president of the United States. You're gonna be fainting on Air Force One, right? So you see this happen. And then I didn't really know how bad it was. And that's why I want to show you. You guys probably heard about this, but look at this video. Let's play this video. Look at this video that they shot of her. Look at her. That's her over there in the yellow hair right there. Watch her feet. Watch her feet. That's her. That's Hillary right there. Watch them try to surround her. Look at this. Look at this. Look at her foot right here. Look at this. She falls down. See her dragging? They literally had to drag that woman into the van. And this detail, of course, look at these fools. They're all trying to cover it up. Do you see her foot dragging there? You see how sick that woman is? That woman is collapsing. Why? The micro and macrocosm are connected. As we attack the heresy of the Han Mother, who represents the era of fallen Eve and the era of the fallen woman and the power of the fallen woman, then as the illusion of her power becomes exposed and the noontime sun is shining, beating upon them, and the more lies they create, the more lies they surround themselves with. They have to create more and more lies to cover up the lies that they've been telling people, right? And they literally start imploding. And on the same time, the macrocosmic level, where more and more Americans are starting to wake up, more and more are starting to turn to Trump, Black Hispanic are now huge portions of Black Hispanic communities are voting for Trump. You see that? Even though they try to say he's racist, he's whatever, whatever, right? He's a homophobe. There's a huge, even the gay community is voting with Trump, you know? I mean, everybody is starting to jump ship. And at the same time, and the macro, Hillary, who is the symbol of the fallen woman, the arrogant, elitist, establishment, prostitute to power, you know, taking money from evil nations who oppress women, yet pretending she's a feminist. It's all illusion. It's all lies. So it's all fake. Pretending she's for peace when this woman has started three wars, four, how many wars under the Clintons? Eight wars plus with Obama? How many wars have they started? So as those lies are starting to collapse, her demonic power, because what do we study in Freedom Society? We study at the elite level, and you guys saw it with those testimonies by 60 Minutes. Wasn't that amazing? The 60 Minutes actually did something good. 60 Minutes, right? In London, in Britain. They covered the scandal of the pedophile cults that were amongst the top elites, like the members of Congress and the House of Lords. Remember that we saw this week? Where they had interviews of the people, the guy is now 50 years old, but he was being raped at like 8 years old by these crusty, fat, you know, slimy nobles, you know. And then he's going, you know, remember that whole 60 Minutes program on that we watched? So at the top, of course, we Cook Jin-Im, of course, brought out the point that they mentioned they were doing secret ceremonies in the woods, remember? But they didn't say it was Satanism. Remember that? They don't want to say that it's Satanism. But they're trying to say, oh, we're covering this and we're investigating this. Of course, nothing happened. Nothing happened to those politicians. Nothing happened to those people. They all got off scot-free. 60 Minutes, you know, did their little part to pretend as if they're investigating and they're going to help bring justice when nothing happened, of course, right? To those people. No justice was given. But by studying this, we see that first, there's real evil in the world. There is real evil. There's organized evil. Organized evil. There's organized evil. I love how Cook Jin-Hem said. He said, how do you get 100 people to go along with a conspiracy? You kill 5 of them. If you kill 5 of them, the other 95 shut up. They won't talk about it. Because if they see those people start getting whacked, they're going to say, oh, Shemitah, if I say something, I'm dead. You see what I mean? And this is how the matrix of power is maintained. The devil and the archangel power maintains power by what? The nexus of the connection between what? Money and murder. They monopolize money and they monopolize murder. And that's how they can get hundreds of people, thousands of people to go along with it. Because it sounds crazy, right? How can 1,000 people go along with it? How can 100 people go along with it without revealing anything? Well, it's called murdering a couple of them. If you murder a couple of them, they'll shut up. That makes sense? Yes. Yeah? Yep. And it's real. Yep. So one thing that Cook Jin-Hem is leading us on in this Freedom Society journey, deep, deep, is that, number one, there is evil in the world. So all these stupid relativists who brainwash you in college and brainwash you in high school and brainwash you through the public school system, there's no real good and evil. It's all relative. It depends on your morality. You create your own morality. Yeah, okay. Everybody here knows we've talked about this a billion times, right? Yeah. That is the trope of the devil, to make you try to believe that there is no good and evil. Why? Because they're committing evil. They're committing organized evil. So they don't want you to call evil evil. They want you to call it good because they're in power and they can do it. You see what I'm saying? So they have a vested interest in relativizing good versus evil. Right? Because if there is a clear understanding, a clear mental picture of good and evil versus evil, if people understand the Ten Commandments, separate good and evil, then you can easily see these fools are wicked evil. They're raping these children. They're child trafficking. You see that video on the 60 Minutes? The 60 Minutes covered it, right? These politicians, they're going to the foster care homes, right? That's the kids with no parents that are put in these foster care homes. And then they're using that as a source to steal children and then sell them off to these politicians who want to rape them. And then the interview before that, remember the 60 Minutes interview in Australia before that, the 2 weeks before that we saw with that girl who was giving testimony when she was 8 years old. By the time she was 11, she was pregnant 7 times. Because she was thrown by her crazy, evil, satanic, witch, devil, grandma. Not grandma's not always nice. This grandma was putting this child in a satanic cult, smiling at her while 7 and 8 men are raping her and having pedophilia with her. Right? Meanwhile, these are the people that are fighting for... What is it they call it? Minor attraction syndrome. Pedophilia should not be considered as a crime. It's a disease. It's a illness. They're born with it. What, haven't we heard this argument with the homosexual agenda? Haven't we heard this argument with the transgender agenda? Haven't we heard this argument now coming with the pedophilia agenda, where they're now in Germany decriminalize pedophilia by saying it's an illness? And of course, they're trying to do incest, which they call genetic attraction syndrome. You see this? These people are engaged in this, which is the reason why they're trying to justify it in the popular culture to be okay. Because these people, that young woman who gave that 60 Minutes interview, remember what she said they would do? They would rape her. They would pass her around. She was like 8 years old. And then if she had a baby, what would they make her do? What would they make her do? They would make her kill it, right? So they would make her kill it, just like, because Satan rituals, they were doing, remember how they explained, they would do different animal sacrifices to practice. And then they would basically cut the baby from the, what? From open up like an animal. And then what would they do? Remember the interviewer asked her, then what would they do? What did she say? They'd make her eat it. They'd make her eat the child. You see this, folks, at the highest levels of power, concentrated archangelic power, where they have the illusion of prim and proper. The British people have the illusion of, oh, we're so prim and proper, right? You have all the illusions of prim and proper, and we're nice people. Behind the scenes, they're child trafficking, raping children, making those children kill their children and eat them. That is what they're doing, right? And not only those elites there, you saw the police officers that came up in Australia. They were saying we would be crazy not to believe that this is not happening in Australia or in the United States. We know that the Bush was running the prostitution ring, the child prostitution ring in Washington. That's been reported by the Washington Times and different news outlets. Father was absolutely right. He saw Bush. He said, you are the father of Satan's world. I'm sorry, the king of Satan's world. And then he publicly named him a king of Satan's culture, Pumbongwang. Father was 100% right. He saw right through those fools. And this is happening at the elite top level, right? This is what's happening. And of course, Kukjong says it goes deeper, and we're going to study going deeper. But the reality is that these things are put out, they're reported on in the public. But the next day, people forget about them. So that ability for people to hear something and then forget about it, that's exactly what Satan uses to do it again. That makes sense? So you see, this type of wickedness, demonic presence, what were they saying to that young girl? Why were they making her ritually sacrifice her children, kill them, and then eat them? What did she say they were making? Why? What was the purpose of that? Remember that? What is it? What was it? Lucifer likes it. That's what they told me. Satan likes it. Remember, and then they had the two different psychologists who have been professional, they work with the police, etc., that investigated her study, and they said, she's not lying. She's telling the truth. They had two major psychologists on that program analyzing her story and her testimony. And both of them concluded, no, she's not lying. She has definitely experienced this. At the top of that archangelic power, folks, it's not just human beings. It is devils. There are devils there. They may be in the flesh of human, or may have possessed and controlled these fleshly bodies. But there are demons there. There are Satan. Satan is there. Satan is the force behind that type of evil. And the trying to dumb down the public to make sure, oh, come on, you don't believe those things. Come on, those things are comic books. Give me a break. Exactly. That's what they need the public to believe, to continue to do their satanic rites, right? These things are real, folks. People's lives are being destroyed, massacred. People are being murdered. People are being offered up in sacrifice, eaten flesh because of these satanic forces and people. There is a great, grand difference between somebody who worships Jesus and Jehovah and somebody who worships Satan. Big difference. It's called the difference between heaven and hell. And heaven and hell is real. Where you will spend your eternity with whom? Both places are personal. You're going to be spending time with somebody. Just who? Who are you going to be spending time with? This is a problem. So you see this type of reality that when we attack Satan's microcosm, if you think about it, the Han mother is at the microcosm. This whole battle is at the microcosm of the universe. Look, folks, that's not a people when they're walking with Jesus Christ around Jerusalem and Galilee. They're walking around in sandals on dirt roads. They had no clue they're walking in the center of the universe. They had no clue. Maybe at times the 12 disciples felt it a little bit, but I'm sure they doubted it. If he's the center of the cosmos, why doesn't he just like... and just make everybody bow to him? Why is he wasting his time walking on these dirt roads between this city and Tyre and, you know, and Capernaum and blah, blah, blah? Why are you wasting your time? Just show your cojones. Just show them. Just show your power. Make everybody just bow down. Come on, you know? They had no clue. They're walking in the middle of the cosmos. They're walking at the center of providence. They're walking in the midst of God. They had no idea. They had no clue. There are 12 people in Jerusalem in the desert. It's not crazy, folks, when we say what happens in Pennsylvania changes the world. It's not crazy. When God leads us here and providence moves with the kingship, doesn't move with the Han blood lineage, when it moves with the line of the blood lineage of the Messiah, what happens in Pennsylvania? And look, Pennsylvania is a swing state. If Trump wins Pennsylvania, he wins America. It's a swing state. It is the central swing state. If he wins here, which many times, it's a purple state. There's a lot of Democrats in the big cities, a lot of Republicans in the countryside. So traditionally, it's a purple state. If he wins here, he wins America. If he wins America, global politics change, folks. Is it really that crazy for me to say that God's a microcosm of the kingship and Cain and Abel coming to Pennsylvania will change the world? Is it really that crazy? Trump is now connected to the kingship. His son, as his representative, came to meet Cain and Abel in the wilderness. That is a Bible story right there. That's crazy. That's crazy. Global politics is being changed. Everybody say we're crazy. Trump would never come there. We didn't make it happen. God made him come here. It is incredible. What happens in Pennsylvania literally will change, will determine who will become the president of the United States, which will determine global politics, folks, whether we move towards globalism and the last straw, or whether we move towards sovereignty. The releasing of the Chenehu Constitution, the releasing of the Family Fraud Constitution, clear picture of worldwide communism and sovereignty. Same battle, micro, macro. And as we attack the heresy of the Han Mother, literally the fallen woman in the macrocosmic level literally starts collapsing. Do you see her collapsing? Her demonic power is being sucked out of her of her range. And look at these, look at that fallen woman. She supports what? Kill those children. Get abortions. Women's health services. It's for your health, women. Kill your children. They're annoying anyways. What did Cook Jin-im say to you? He said amazing. He said, ladies, you got to be real. The reason why you don't want to take care of your kids, because they're your mirror. They make you look at yourself. That's why you're annoyed by your kids. How true is that? How many ladies can honestly say that's true? Come on, you're being real. We got real women here. You see? I mean, this is, it's amazing. The macro and micro is moving. What did we tell mother 3 years ago? We told her, you have 3 years. You disobey, you desecrate father, you go down to my mother, father will come to judge you. Yes. Look at father. He's literally killing, taking out some of the main leaders who are not only out of position. For example, somebody like Kamiyama. He knows the truth, but he played politics. And now he has pancreatic cancer. He will die. Right? In the direct dominion of God, Father said, you interfere with God's promise, you will be taken to the spirit world. You'll be taken. Anyone who isn't with me opposes me, and anyone who isn't working with me is actually working against me. It is the reality of now that's what's happening in the microcosm, collapsing. Leadership is committing suicide, dying off with cancer, no more legitimacy. Members are, even in Korea now, even in that letter that's circulating, that anonymous minister wrote, he's saying, mother, nobody is listening to you on the ground. No member thinks you're right. He didn't say like we were right or anything, but he was saying, no member thinks you're right. You've got to stop this insanity. And then, of course, he mentions, how can you prepare an offering table like that to the King of Kings? Did you see their offering table? They just threw a couple of bananas on the table. Oh, Father, you're born in the year of the monkey. You monkey, have some bananas. You piece of junk. What a despicable group of pitiful heretics. Despicable group. So all that reality is coming out. We've been telling you all that for 3+ years. Worldwide member, maybe 2 years or so, right? Nobody else has told you the truth. Everything that we have said came true. I told you she would declare herself as Messiah. She did. I told you she would declare herself as God. She did. I told you she would declare herself as only begotten. She did. Am I wrong? We told you. It was not hard. It was not easy to tell the truth and to get through all that social and political and all that correctness and all that crud. But we had to. We have to seek truth. We have to seek truth. When we seek truth, God gives us the answer. When we knock, God opens the door. When we seek, he will let us find. But we have to seek, really, with a sincere heart. Be willing to be wrong. If you get an answer you don't like, too bad. That's the truth. Ooh, didn't make me feel good. So what? It's the truth. Grow up, you little baby. Take your diapers off. Do some push-ups. Run some stairs. Grow up. Oh, Lord, have mercy. They get me going. You see, so you can see the micro and macrocosm moving together. Who would have ever predicted the icon of the fallen woman on the macrocosm, Hillary, is collapsing literally? I mean, who would? Did any of you predict that 2 months ago? How many of you poo-pooed the, oh, Hillary's not really, I think those right-wing people are a little crazy. Blah, blah, blah. How many did that? Come on, be honest. How many kind of doubted those? Okay, one. I know there's more than one. Okay, but look what's happening now. They're literally, they cannot deny it. The woman is collapsing on national TV, coughing fits, etc. Their illusions of power are collapsing worldwide. Deutsche Bank collapsing in the stocks on Friday. That is the Central Bank of Europe, folks. The crash is coming. The currencies are crashing. They're crashing. Just like we told you. Just didn't we say right before we go to Maine, we may have a big crash? How many heard that a couple weeks ago? Yeah. There is a direct movement, macro and micro. We are not fighting against flesh and blood. The argument we're having is not against flesh and blood. This is not, it's not even in our family. The argument that is happening, the fight, the war that is going on is between God and Satan. Literally, people are demonically possessed. Lust after money, lust after power, lust after position, lust after whatever it is. They are literally consumed by the power of evil. This is what's so powerful about this whole section here. In the kingdom, notice, of course, Jesus chases out the devil. He says, what does he say down here? If I cast out demons by the power of God, then the kingdom of God has arrived. Notice that when the kingdom of God arrives, the devils are cast out. Do you notice that? There is a violent casting out. Expulsion, I like that. Exorcism of the demonic force. When we look at this on the national level, when Jesus is talking about the kingdom, he's talking on a national level. If we look at this on a national level, look at this, folks. Look at some of the healings Jesus does. When these people are possessed by the devil, when they are dominated by Archangel, what happens? They can't speak. They can't see. They can't hear. They can't walk. They can't move. Now, look at that on the national level. When a country is dominated by the ideology of Satan, which is communism, socialism, feminism, whatever veer it has, the socialist structure, the communist structure, centralized archangelic power, right? When you look at any nation state that becomes sick and possessed with that type of satanic disease, cancer, what happens to those nations? Can they speak freely? Okay, so they get mute. They get the sickness of mute. Can those nations see clearly? No, are you allowed to open up internet sites that help people see clearly? No. Okay, so you have propaganda, right? You have mainstream media. You have state-controlled media. Which what? Then can the people see clearly? No. They're blind. The nation is blind. Isn't that interesting? They can't hear. They can't hear about a different kingdom. They're not allowed to. The radio stations are controlled. The type of music you play is controlled, right? So what happens to that nation? Just like Jesus. Look, Jesus healed people who were blind, who were deaf, mute, couldn't move. Look at that on a national level. When you get infected with the archangelic cancer of centralized government, what do you become as a nation? If you were a man, let's say a nation was anthropomorphized as a person, you would become blind, you would become mute, you would become deaf, and you cannot move. You're sick. Isn't that interesting? So, When the finger of God comes and touches that person and chases out that devil, what happens? What's restored? Sight, sound, I can speak. You see? I can speak. Now, does that sound kind of similar to what happens when people are liberated from communism or centralized government? Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? It is a spiritual connection to either God or Satan, which determines whether or not you will be free, healthy, whether you'll be sick, ill, deaf, dumb, and blind in the national level. Isn't that interesting? Look at verse 21. Wow, look at verse 21. For when a strong man is fully armed, you hear that? When a strong man is fully armed and guards his palace, who lives in a palace? Kings and queens, right? Okay, so when a strong man is fully armed and guards his palace, notice it didn't say a palace, it said his palace. Does that mean sovereignty or does that mean communism? Sovereignty. Because it's his palace, which means what? The kings and queens, it's the Chinese constitution. Citizens are kings and queens. They have sovereignty. They have palaces. They have territory. They have kingdoms. And when a strong man is fully armed and guards his palace, his possessions are safe. His possessions are safe. Isn't that fascinating? When an evil spirit leaves a person, it goes in the desert, finds an hour return, former home is also, look at that. Once the evil disease spirit is chased out of that nation, what happens? That house becomes what? It becomes clean and it becomes orderly. Notice that the devil always promises that he will give you order. He will let you have control of your life if you just trust him. If you just give your soul to him, he'll let you have power over your life. He'll give you what you want, right? Right? That's what he promises. But he screws up your life. He sold you lies, and now all you got is hell. He sold you the lies that good men are bad, bad boys are good men, will make good husbands, and the ones that tell you, oh baby, I'm gonna wait till we get married. We're gonna get married. We can do this, we're gonna get married. Oh, okay, he said he's gonna get married. And after he uses you, he spit you out in the trash. And then you're crying, oh, how could that happen? Oh, that you loved me. You dummy. You dumb girl. You see what happened? He sells you lies, gives you the opposite. He says he's going to give you free money. He gives you messed up families. He gives you collapsing communities. Anything he promises, he says he'll make you safer. He makes your communities more dangerous, more drugs, more crime, more delinquency, irresponsible women, irresponsible men. That's what he makes. But he promised you he would make your neighborhood better. He promised you he would get rid of crime, fight crime. He promised you he'd make you safe. All the communist lies. He promised you he would educate your children. They find a job. All they got is $200,000 of debt and no job. He told you they would be well-adjusted. Now they're wearing skirts. say, I'm empowered. What's Will Smith's son, this boy, this wacko boy? He thinking he's empowered. I'm empowered, I'm in a skirt, baby. Boy, you are screwed in the head. You're out your mind. Cellulize gives you destruction. But then they chase out that spirit. And what happens? That home is all swept in. Look at that. Look at the result. You chase out the archangel. What do you get? Everybody warned you, oh, if you chase the archangel out, you'll be no more safe. Who will defend your children? Who will give you your food stamps? Who will give you free money? Who will give you the... Nobody will take care of you. The greedy corporate businesses will all steal your jobs. Right? This is what they say all the time. And what happens in nations that chase out centralized archangel government? They become wealthy. They start prospering. Small and medium-sized businesses can begin again without all those crazy restrictions. People can start freely pursuing the gifts God gave them. You start having success. You start having prosperity. You start having responsibility. That's what you get. So the house becomes in order. But look at this. Notice. Notice the spirit of Satan. He lies to you, screws it up, then blames it on somebody else to get off the hook. And once he's exposed, so once he's out, kicked out of the house, then the house becomes prosperous. Then what happens to that fool, Satan? Is he happy with that? Now he's angry with that. You kicked me out, and it all got better. Well, I'll show you what's better. Come back with seven of my boys. Seven other spirits. Come back who are bigger than me. More deadly than me. More liars and bigger liars than me, right? And comes in and wreaks havoc. We have to understand, folks, on a national level, this is always the tendency of the spirit world of Archangel. As he is chased out, always he will try to amass more power secretly to overthrow. And that is why the Chunhyang Constitution is such a spiritual document. It is not a legal document, folks. If you study it, you will realize how incredibly spiritual that document is. It is the antidote, the wall. It is the defense, the home security alarm. It is the jujitsu. It is the MMA against predators, okay? It is the firearm that chases out of the robber. It is the shotgun that grandma can pick up and chase out five hoodlums trying to rape her children and steal from her house. It is that weapon. And it cannot be changed. This is what's so powerful about it. This is why the devils hate it. Because even though they come back with seven times more, as long as the citizens, those who are the kings, the strong man defends his, fully armed, defends his palace, as long as the citizens remain in their positions. Even if those devils come back with their gangs and their devil bloods and crips in the spirit world, as long as the citizens stay strong and obey the rights given by God through the Constitution and don't let them go, those devils will be able to be chased off. Now, we know in the book of Revelation, after the millennial reign, the thousand-year reign of Christ, there is a time where Satan reemerges to try to overthrow everything, just like this story. He tries to do it. He tries to do it. But he was successful with all the foundation level and all the growth level nations. But Chunhyang, the kingdom of God in Christ, and the lineage of God, the millennial reign, is a different type of kingdom. It comes from the seed of Almighty God. Not only the mind seed, it comes from the seed, the lineage, the spermata. It comes from the true king. And that's why when the devils try to destroy it, which they will try. When they try to destroy it, it will be unlike any kingdom they have faced. Unlike any kingdom, dissimilar to any opponent they have ever faced. They're dealing with a different blood. They're dealing with a different blood. Now, why is it so important to understand the blood lineage? Remember, folks, when you have a kingdom, that kingdom comes from a single king. That's where it comes from. It comes from a king whose seed is passed down. And that whole kingdom and the territory is from that king. Now, the reason why that's important is because that king is a person. So it's important to understand the culture of that person. If you believe and follow a false true father, you will be learning a false culture. A false culture that is separated from the kingdom of God. Out from that king comes a culture. Father owned, he as the king of kings, he didn't own anything. Father, as a king of kings, he was in the golden cage. His life was on transparent to everybody to see. Never has a private moment. He lived that way his whole life. Father had a culture of, and we hear it all the time, but we don't connect it to the kingdom. The culture of work. Living in the natural world, delighting in the natural things. A culture where he expected and encouraged his children to be strong. This is what, of course, what we're doing with the young people. The young people who are training with me, you guys are not only training jujitsu and MMA, you're training with True Father. You understand? I am Teishinja. I am Father's representative. I didn't choose that. He chose that. When you train with me, you're not just training martial arts. You're training kingdom culture. You're learning about the King of Kings. They also become powerful people. Father called it the peace police, peace militia. We talked about it last week. People may have heard us talk about it, but actually many times people are confused what exactly it is. Because in our mind, we have so many different images and or pictures of what we think these things are. And of course, if you come and you watch us training and stuff like that, you can see there is a culture that's being developed. Hard work, responsibility, we get into all that. But it is a different type of culture, folks. What did Kuk Chin Nam say? One of the freedom standards, he said, and he was talking to the lady, he said, ladies, every tyrant needs your vote. How true is that? Look in the beginning. In order for Satan to take over the garden, he needed whose vote? He needed Eve's vote. Now, if you are a politician and you want to become a tyrant like Hitler, Nazi, Stalin, any one of those fools who became dictators, who do they target? Which population group do they target to vote for more centralized power, promising them more safety and more security? It's the women. You women will decide the fate of civilization. If you give it up to the devil, you screw it up. If you obey God and value yourself and keep yourself, you save the kingdom. Every dictator needs to capture you. And ladies, you're easy to capture because bad men can scare you. You're easy to scare. Flash a little spider. Ah! I used to always rag on my wife, joke on my wife. She gets freaked out as small as they saw. It's the most fun thing to do. Hide behind a door. Wow! Ah! Oh my God, what are you doing? Ah! It's just the most hilarious thing. It's ridiculous. I mean, she's a grown woman, but it's ridiculous. That doesn't work on no man. You see, it's a different culture. Ladies, it's a different culture. Look at these realities. This is the story of Sun Tzu. This was brought up in Freedom Society. That's why I looked this up. This is a story of the concubines. Have you heard this about the King Wu and Sun Tzu? He wrote The Art of War. And how he came to power to work under the King of Wu, the Wu state, is that the king said, okay, I got all these girls, I got all these concubines. And they won't listen. They will never be able to fight in military maneuver. They will never be able to do martial arts. They will never be able to do these kind of things. They just giggle. They just giggle at things. I can't get them to do anything in a formation. So he says, if you can get these girls to move in formation, I will make you the general or whatever. It will give you this power. Okay. So Sun Tzu goes up there. This is Sun Tzu here. You see, he's there with the wispy Asian beard, because Asian people can't grow a full beard. And there he is with his long robes, you know. And there he is speaking Chinese. Okay, I speak Chinese, so that's real Chinese, okay? That is real Chinese. I'm not making up. If you know Chinese, I'm speaking real Chinese. Okay? And he's telling them, so what did he say? They had these two girls down here, okay, at the bottom that you see, and they were supposed to be the generals of their groups, okay? And so those two ladies, they're the head concubines or whatever, they told them, okay, now do this maneuver. And all the ladies go, you know, the little robe and giggle. So then Sun Tzu goes, execute them. And so they're being ticked off, and then their heads are chopped off. And after he slits their throat and chops their head off, all the other girls in line, they maneuver left, right, left, right, left, right. They move perfect. What is this illustrative of? Ladies, you're so easy to scare. The archangel will work on your insecurity and your anxiety. Yes. All your little things that you have about yourself to scare you, to make you believe you need him. And if you believe in him, he will protect you. He will take care of you. He'll make you happy. He'll empower you. And what do you get after 50 years of that? You get your families are taken away. You become murderers because you aborted your children. You have chased away good men. Your societies and your sons are criminals. And you have no money. You work three jobs only for it to be stolen by the government, by your big daddy pimp, and you have nothing. You've been sold a lie. Sold a lie. Look at this poll by Gallup. This is actually the Gallup website. Women more likely to be Democrats regardless of age. Women are almost double the percentage compared to men will vote Democrat. Guess what? Why they some people suggest that is because women are nurturers And the Democratic Party positions itself to be nurturers. When they're pimp daddies, guess what? Don't pimp daddies say, oh, baby, I'm going to nurture you. Don't pimp daddies say, oh, baby, you work with me, you're going to get money. You're going to be good. You're going to be all right. You're going to look good. You're going to make it all. You just got to work for me. Don't pimp daddies do that? And what happens? These are the actual numbers here. Here's the graphs. I'm sorry. Here are the graphs. Almost double. You cannot say men and women behave the same. They don't. Look at how they vote. It's totally almost opposite. This dark green line is women that vote for the Democratic Party, the Communist Party, folks. The Communist Party. You women are voting for the Communist Party. Why? Because it sounds more maternal. We have to share with everybody. We have to share, even though we have to steal from people and point guns at these guys. Don't say that. Don't say that. We'll just call it sharing. Even though we have to kill those people, no, I don't want to hear about that. Just call it sharing. we'll murder children. No, it's called Women's Health Services, remember. Don't say murdering children, that's terrible. Say Women's Health Services. This is what you're doing. And this is where the country goes. Becomes worse than Babylon. That's the real statistics. Look at that. They sucker the women, pimp the women to jump on that train. Oh, you're going to get free stuff. You vote for me, you get free stuffs. Oh, who cares if it doesn't last forever? It's going to be fun when we do it. It's going to be great when we do it. Irresponsibility. What else do they teach? Victimization. Oh, you're a victim. Oh, you're a victim. Yes, you make 70 cents where 77 cents where men make a dollar. Only the Democrats are fighting for you. How many heard this one? There's a new one with that celebrity. There's one stupid bimbo celebrity who's part of this thing, and she's making the stupidest video about the same idiotic statistics, which are false. Oh, yes, in America, it's a great, you don't have to outsource your jobs to China and India. You have free slave labor here. It's called women. This is what they make this video, like try to be sarcastic, right? And their stats are all off. They don't mention, for example, that 93% of fatalities in workplaces are men. Women don't choose dirty jobs. Women choose service and hobby-related jobs. Women work part-time on average. Men have to work full-time. Men have to get sucked into war. Men have to work in places where they get their hands chopped off by a saw. Men have to get killed by a tree that's falling on them. The women aren't voting for those. So when you look at all professions, and compare all professions, then, per profession, when you look at per profession, there's no difference in pay gap, zero. When you do it all together, including full-time workers, men are almost all full-time workers, and women are almost all part-time workers, and they take more vacation leave and more maternity leave, et cetera, than men, well, yes, of course, then you get paid less. You're working less, you're working part-time, and you're taking up more time. What universe do you live in? Of course, then you get paid less if you work less, on average. They've done studies on some of the CEOs who have been sold that, oh, that's the only way you can find value as a woman and be powerful as a woman is to boss around men in a suit, and you know, you'll be empowered because you'll have your suit skirt on, but hey, you know, you can boss those men around. Be your CEO in your desk and you're taking phone calls and you're busy. You're empowered. You're competing with men. What do they find with CEO women? They're the most unhappy people. Dysfunctional families, broken up marriages, no real relationships. Totally unhappy people. So what? You got some money. There's a lot of people with money who are living in hell. These are the real stats. Now, in the kingdom culture, from a young age, men and women, because look, there's no federalized police, there's no federalized military, young people from a young age have to train in protecting their communities. First of all, they have to learn how to become bullyproof themselves. They have to learn how to defend themselves first. So in the kingdom, you will see things like Brazilian jiu-jitsu. You will see things like mixed martial arts. You will see things like shooting sports. You will see things like hunting and fishing and farming. You will see these things as the main practices of almost everybody. Why? Because every community will be responsible for their security. So then it becomes a community member's responsibility from a young age to at least know basic arts of self-defense. It's us and reliance, self-reliance. It is a central part of the culture of Chunigu. It's not just a fluke that Jesus was a weapons manufacturer. I love how he manufactured whips to beat up bankers. It's not a surprise that Jesus, when he returns with True Father, his first manufacturing business was the air gun rifle. Later on became the Vulcan cannon, which worked with the defense industry of the nation to help arm the South Korean peoples. Not a surprise that the elder brother Cain is continuing that tradition on a high level, very high level, in a competitive, hugely competitive industry, successful. Not a surprise. It's not a coincidence that father's successor, of course, I'm in the shooting community, I'm in the shooting sports, but of course that I love the martial arts as a way of cultivating people, training. This is a young lady. She's in her 20s. Her name is Mackenzie Dern. She looks like a sweet girl, right? She looks like a sweet lady, right? Nice lady, nice girl, right? Looks like a nice girl and probably a little bit of a wimp, right? Pretty girl is kind of wimpy. This girl is a world champion Brazilian jiu-jitsu fighter. She's also now starting her MMA, mixed martial arts career. And one of our sanctuarians went to school with her or something. One of the young people went to school with her, so they know her directly. I hope she comes train with us one time. Because the young girls, you'd love her. I think you'd love her. But this is a woman that is different than a normal woman. This is what you women do not understand. When you're in the combat sports and combat martial arts from a young age, you are different from normal women. You are not like a normal girl. Of course, you have superpowers. You can choke people out, break arms, break legs, all those kind of things. Yes, that's the normal. But you're also mentally very different. You're very different. It's very interesting because in the shooting community, hunting community, fishing community, fighting community, most people are conservative. Yeah, of course you have some crazy outliers. You always have the crazy liberal in there. Yeah, I'm voting for Hillary. Boo! Right? You always have that fool wherever you go. That's when you wear your Hillary for prison shirt. Right? So you always have some of those fools. But majority of people in those communities are conservative. Their values are conservative. Some of the most violent fighters in the world, they're very good family people. They're extremely good dads and moms, you know, and they invest in their children and they raise them with values and teach them consequences, etc. I'm not saying they're all saints, but I'm saying on average, those communities, isn't it interesting how those communities that practice fishing or hunting, that practice shooting, that practice hard martial arts, not fake martial arts that don't work in real fighting. I'm talking about hard sports like wrestling, football would be another hard sport, MMA, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, any of these hard sports. Notice how they, on average, are more conservative. It's a part of the kingdom culture. A lot of you know this lady, Ronda Rousey. She's a nasty girl. She'll rip your arm off. She will break your arm in half. She's a judo Olympian. She was a UFC women's champion. She lost the belt. She's coming back. But actually, she's interesting. All the feminists wanted her to be a feminist spokesperson. They wanted her to be the male-hating, man-hating, you know, pus-filled, vitriol woman that they yearn to be, which men will look at and say, "You're a devil. I'm never going to date you." She said, "No, I'm not going to be part of that. I believe if women shouldn't be paid equal to men. No, if men can attract more people to the fights, they should get paid more. If women can attract more people and sell more tickets for the fights, they should get paid more." All the feminists are like, "No, don't say that, Ronda Rousey. You have to say our statements for us." She said it very clear. It's a free market. If men's martial arts is better and people want to pay to see it, they should make more. She's real. She's not some stupid fantasy land. She's living in reality. Why? Because she does hard martial arts, which force you to accept reality. You cannot live in delusion doing these kind of martial arts. You cannot. You cannot live in delusion. It becomes a part of you. The type of culture that it breeds is people who are humble yet confident, strong. Strong, but not just necessarily boastful of themselves. Of course, you always have the outliers. I'm not saying 100% like that, right? You always have some folks that are going to use it for bad. But majority of people who train in these arts, you have a different culture. You are a different species, even though you're a woman. You are different. You're mentally different. You're physically different. You have different neural pathways that have developed by the nature of that art, which doesn't allow you to live in delusion, which doesn't allow you to cry for help, which doesn't allow you to, you know, live in insecurities. You have to fight through them. You become a different species. Not get rescued by the guy all the time. That is one tough girl. She'd come and whoop. She could whoop men up. Traditionally, very hard fighting sports like Thai boxing. The reason why I'm showing you these guys, I've talked about them many times, but many people don't know what they are. Okay, so this is Thai boxing. This is Sen Chai, one of the kings of Thai boxing. Amazing fighter. What an incredible scientist. Boy, and he's such an entertainer. He loves fighting. He just has such a blast when he's up there. He's always laughing, smiling to the crowd and going, "Woo, I'm winning." And he's amazing. Anyways, the guy is incredible. This is a small little Thailand guy here. Beats up these big guys. This is Thai boxing, probably one of the most brutal forms of striking sports in the world. You can attack with leg kicks, knees, elbows, and punches. So it's not like boxing, you're punching each other with boxing gloves. You can punch, you can elbow the face, you can kick the entire body, excluding the groin. The entire body, from head to toe, you can kick it, whatever you want. You can knee whatever you want, except for the groin. It is one of the most brutal combat striking sports and martial arts there are. Now you have women who are training all these arts. They're totally different. They're different than normal women. lot of you have heard me talk about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, right? This is Master Jojo in 2009 when he was fighting Pablo Popovich. Look at that monster of a man on top of him. You see that big guy with that no shirt, and he's ripped. This guy is a beast. Master Jojo had to fight him. He lost to him, but he had to fight him. He fought his heart out. Now the kids are training these kind of arts. Very dangerous arts. They are fighting-based arts. They are not delusional. You cannot be delusional because you will get submitted. You will be forced to surrender. How many of you young kids experience the forcing of surrender? Right? All of you experience it. You're forced, otherwise you'll die. You'll either get something broken or you pass out. There's Master Jojo fighting JT Torres, one of the top in the world, world champion. Master Jojo's fought them all. Ryan Hall, he's fought Eddie Cummings. All the top guys, he's amazing. Master Jojo, if you're watching, I'm grateful to be a brown belt under you, my friend. What an amazing jiu-jitsu guy. Our ninjas, our kids who train with me, also we will be training this art. This is called Kali and a Scream. It's a Filipino martial art based on stick fighting and knife fighting. Very deadly, very deadly. I can get you deadly faster with this art than Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Because as you guys know, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu takes time, right? It goes very slow. Like to master those moves and to do it in real fighting, it takes time. A lot of time. I can get you dangerous within a couple of days with this art. Very dangerous. You see? And when we do our ninja weapons training on Friday, plus our bushcrafting, I'm going to have the kids make these sticks. These are called double Eskrima sticks, so they'll learn how to actually use double sticks too. Double stick strategy. Okay? Combined with Kali and knife fighting. I was learning this art since I was 14. I stopped for about 15 years because of Buddhism and et cetera, but I was training these arts. The people who are in these communities are very different. They're hardly ever liberals. Hardly ever. They're supportive of Second Amendment to carry weapons. These people, the Kali community, Eskrima community, these guys are all weapons masters. They support normal citizens having weapons to defend themselves. The community is so different. And this is why it's become so foreign to us, because we're not part of these communities. We don't know people in these communities. Probably the only people you know in these communities is me. Most of you. Right? But there are incredible, incredible people. Their values are almost exactly the same as Christian values. Almost exactly the same. Freedom, responsibility, hard work, diligence, honor, respect, honesty, seeking truth, not being in fantasy land. So when Father talked about peace, police, peace, militia as being the cultural norm of Chaniyaguk, this is what we misunderstand. We don't see that. Instead of PE class in your school, you may have jiu-jitsu every day for the kids, Brazilian jiu-jitsu, so that there's no more bullying, so that the weak kids can actually, if they're attacked or assaulted, they can actually fight back. You wouldn't have just a dumb PE class where you go, bah, 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 and do a little jump rope, and yeah, pull-ups, I did one pull-up today. You would learn something that actually can save your life. And it would be tied directly to the safety of that community. It would be a natural part of the culture, which everybody would learn. Everybody would be empowered to learn that art. Everybody would be brought into that samurai brotherhood. Everybody would be brought into that ninja brotherhood of hard work, training, understanding consequences, understanding good decision-making. You would be brought in naturally by being born. All of you would be, by this age, you would be black belts in jiu-jitsu. All the ladies too. To you would be normal. You look at Mackenzie Dern fighting somebody and you say, oh, she's so sweet and she's so cute. Look at her choking that man. It would just be so normal. You would just, it's something you would already have proficiency in. It would not be something foreign like, oh my gosh, look at what she did. Oh my, amazing. No, you can do it too. You wouldn't worship people who are strong. Try to pretend to wish to be like them. You would be strong. You would be part of a culture where you are strong when you're young. You are raised into a culture of honor, integrity, of keeping your promise, working hard, training hard, respecting your elders, respecting your teacher, etc. Don't be delusional about yourself. You would be just raised up in a culture. It'd be a natural part of the culture. Peace police, peace militia. That's what Father talked about. It's the bedrock cultural sphere. It's one of the main cultural spheres in Chenigu. Because defending our house, our family, our community is a serious responsibility. Especially when those communities are free and they have to be responsible for their own defense. You learn what? When you learn these kind of hard martial arts, what do you learn? You learn decisions have consequences. You make the wrong decision, you're dead. How many of the young people learned that one? You make a wrong move, what happens? It's over. You get choked out. Right? You learn cause and effect. You learn what you heard about in the principle of cause and effect, but you learn it in reality. You experience cause and effect. You experience, if I make this wrong move, I get suffocated and strangled. You learn. You learn it by, you live it by experience. You actually experience the principle of give and take and also cause and effect. You learn that crying doesn't help. My gosh. My wife, she's an artist. An artist. An artist. Okay. She's an artist. So she would, like I said, she's so easy to scare, right? And, you know, I can freak her out, you know, just hide behind a desk and wah, make a big noise. Ah! And I just freak her out. It's so hilarious. And the boys love seeing it too. The young boys especially. But when she first started training, right? Tell me if I'm wrong. When she first started training and she had to fight against even other girls, she would make this face of fear. Like while she's fighting, the girl is trying to pass her guard, going to side control, and she's like this. Like making this face of petrified fear. So I had to shoot a video of her to get some third-party objective feedback. I didn't put it on the internet or nothing, but I did to show her. I said, look at the face you are making when you are fighting. Now, do you think that's going to give your opponent energy? Or is it going to make them feel incapacitated? If you make a facial expression of petrified fear, your opponent will be like, yeah, I'm beating her, you know? You have to hide that. You have to be strong. Even though they're beating you, just go. You gotta keep it strong. You gotta have control over those muscles. You don't let that face move. Right? Even though you're like, if you hurt, you're just, you have to keep that strong spirit. But you know, that is a reflection of your internal state. Whether or not you think it's okay to demonstrate weakness in front of everybody. Or whether or not you think, no, I don't have to demonstrate that. I don't have to make myself weak for people to like me.
I don't need the white man for nothing.
You know? And when she became aware she was making that face, she had to literally make a conscious decision to stop it. Now she doesn't do it. Now you guys see the queen training, right? She's got her mouth guard in. She's got her, you know, samurai face on. She's going. Right? Now you see. Totally different. It's not, ah! It's strong, powerful, beautiful. Sexy and power. Woo, my God. Okay, my goodness. That's what I can say. There I can say my God, because that's not the Lord's name in vain. I'm praising him. You see that? He gave me her so I can praise him. You see that? Crying out, mind over body, mind over body. Fantasy versus reality. In her testimony she gave last week and also in the Korean service, she said she didn't even know. She thought she just bought into the feminism stuff and she said, yeah, I'm tough and blah, blah, blah. But when she actually started training, she realized, well, I thought I was tough, but I'm a wimp. And I'm like, yes, yeah, that's right. Right. You have to face reality. You literally have to face reality. Some of the girls that we thought are the wimpiest girls, they become tough. Where's Mariana? Where's Mariana? Where's she at? That girl, Mariana, she's small and she's always so nice. Oh, yo. We thought she's a, what is this girl? We better take it easy on Marianne. And she was getting beat up like crazy in the beginning. All the girls were beating her up, smashing her. That girl did not give up. She does not get, she taps. I'm not saying she doesn't tap, but she keeps on coming the next day, even though she don't want to come. She comes the next day. You got these tough girls, maybe be with us a couple of times, and they're running away. And here you got tiny little Marianne, oh, I'm so eager. And then she's there, and then every day she's training, and now you girls train with her, right? You see how much better she got. It's so surprising. You learn mental and physical toughness. You learn a mindset that's different. The mindset is different. The cultural mindset is different. You learn mental toughness, you learn physical toughness. How many of you guys are now enjoying that feeling of soreness after training? How many of you guys enjoying that? Oh, come on, you stinky man. Okay, well, you got to do a lot, maybe two more years, then you'll start enjoying it. Man, you're going to feel that, like, oh, I feel that soreness. Oh, it feels good. I feel sore, but it feels good. Like, you get addicted to that healthy, healthy feeling body. You know? Mental and physical toughness. You learn how to control your emotions. Fear, depression. How many times, when I made you guys fight for the first time, how scared were you? Come on, guys. There's a lot of fear involved, isn't there? It's scary. It's so scary because, like, this is not like you're playing tennis with somebody. You got to fight this fool. And this person is either going to beat you up or you're going to beat her up. Right? It's not like, I beat you in ping pong. I killed you. I killed you. I can kill you. That's what it means. So they have to overcome their emotions of fear. Now, think about that, folks. From a young age, you saw the Gallup polls where women can be, you can use scare tactics on them and promise them security and they'll vote for a Democrat. If culturally, all the women of the nation are not just in PE class, they're being empowered with real martial arts. Or these different types of sports, which build more conservatism in you, which make you more conservative by the nature of reality. Because you're facing reality all the time, you have to become more conservative. You're not going to be stupid with your decisions. Because you learn, I make a dumb decision, I get killed. I lose. Yep. You learn there's a consequence. Dominion over your feelings. People can't manipulate your feelings as much as easy. All those propaganda, you know, advertisements that manipulate women's feelings and, oh, you get paid 70 cents on the dollar, women. Join our cause to centralize government and steal money from people. You're going to say, what are you talking about? No, I'm going to do my research. I'm not controlled by my feelings. You learn that I don't want to train this week, so what? I'm going to train. My body hurts, so what? I'm going to train. You know the best way to get rid of soreness is to train. People think, oh, get rid of soreness, you rest it out. No, you don't know what you're talking about. The best way to get rid of soreness is to train. You heal your soreness with more training. Not overtraining, but with training. Not overtraining. dominion over feelings, control over emotions, fear, depression, anxiety. How many, oh my goodness. My wife, she will be in the room. All of a sudden, will get up and start doing push-ups on the floor. Then she will start doing these jujitsu drills alone on the floor, rolling around. And I'm looking over her and say, who is that? Who is that? That is incredible. It's amazing. I mean, it's amazing. It's great. It's very entertaining to watch. But it's fantastic. It's very, and I can fix her because I'm her instructor. I'm a master. So I can fix her up. But it's amazing to see her. She is being self-motivated to become more realistic, more strong, more powerful, but responsible. It's incredible. You learn how to compete against other strong warriors. You learn how to compete against strong people. Think about people who never competed against a strong person. They maybe competed once and now they play soccer because they don't want to compete against the big football kids. I know all you soccer kids. I know what you're thinking. You know you're scared of those football kids. You know you are. You just don't admit it. I don't got nothing against soccer, but I'm saying a lot of boys get scared because they know they're going to get beat up. They don't realize that if they just go do football and they go through it, they're going to be way stronger than they ever become, and those strong kids are going to become your friends. This is what you don't realize. Those wrestlers, the strong kids, you're scared of them. That's why you play soccer and tennis. You know that soccer and tennis is not going to save your life. You're scared of those wrestlers. Be real. You're scared. Get over the fear. Once you start training with those guys, you start sweating with them. So what? You suck. Everybody sucks at first. Everybody stinks at first. Everybody gets smashed at first. Stop crying about it and just go the next day. That's all you got to do. And all those kids will appreciate you as long as you push through like that. Even though you're weak, they'll think, man, this guy's tough. He's mentally tough. He hung through the whole season. He's coming back the next season. Man, okay, I like him. He's not so bad. You get tough. You compete against strong warriors. So what is that? If you are used to competing against strong people, does that make you more scared of strength, or will you be less scared of strength? Now, if you never competed against strong people, all you can do is fantasize about competing against strong people. All you can do is play a stupid video game to make yourself feel better about your soccer days or tennis. That's all you can do. But you know in your mind you were scared. You know in your mind you were scared, but nobody called you out on it. Nobody told you the truth. You know you were a chicken. But if you're used to competing against strong people, you don't have that. You're not scared. You're not as scared. You still feel nervous. You still get butterflies, but you're not as scared. You see what I mean? And this is why women, this is such a tragedy in the modern day. Women hardly ever do these kind of combat sports. So they're never able to become tough. They think they're tough playing basketball. You're not tough. Ronda Rousey will kill you. Misha Tate will kill you. Mackenzie Dern will kill you. You see? But in Chunigoo, think about it. All the girls, all the boys, it's just part of growing up. It's part of growing up in that culture where you are responsible for your own personal defense too. You have to have those skills. Plus, you have to be willing to help other people too, protect them too. Your purpose of your empowerment is not for your own glory. It's to help preserve everybody else's freedoms too. You have a larger mission. You learn for fighting for something greater than you, larger mission, respect, honor. Look at this. You learn how to harness power. You learn how to harness force and power. These little girls, these girls now, they look like normal girls. They're not normal girls. These girls now, who are training for us, even a couple months, they're not normal girls anymore. They can now kill people. I'm not joking. They can kill people. So it's a very dangerous power. You see what I'm saying? See how much responsibility that comes with? When you start learning how and cultivating this type of power and the use of force, you learn how dangerous it is. So you don't just go around beating people up. Yes, you always have a couple outliers, and they use it for bad. You always have a couple of those, a couple percent of people. But the majority of people who learn these arts, if they're given good, if they have a good instructor and a good professor over them, they will learn how to harness real power, real power. With my empty hands, I can kill people. These guys who train with me thought I was just saying that to boast of myself. Am I boasting, guys? Whoever trains with me, am I boasting? I can kill people with my open hands, my body. These guys now can do so too, more and more. They're now at a different level in terms of their life. They're actually having to harness and control power, real, deadly power. So that comes with responsibility. It comes with a very important responsibility that you have, a sovereign responsibility. Look at this wheel. We talked about this, conservative theory versus liberal theory. Remember this? And look at conservative theory. You have strong families, which build childhood success, which build pursuit of competition, which then build acceptance of inequality, which builds free market, which then builds stronger families, which then builds more childhood success, more pursuit of competition, more acceptance of inequality, and more free market, stronger families, etc. When you train in these type of arts, you have to accept competition. It's part of it. Competition is part of it. The kids who don't want to do competition, I know you're scared. You're scared of it. You're scared of losing. You have to overcome that fear and challenge yourself, because it's you that's stopping that potential coming out. You're the one who's chicken. You're the one who's scared. You have to face it. You have to push through it. That's what you learn in these kind of hard martial arts. You learn competition, pursuing competition, the joy of competition. It's nerve-wracking, etc. It's joyful. Donald, too, he's a black belt taekwondo. I'm going to make him fight some of my white belts. Oh, you got to work on technique a little bit. You got to work on a technique. He's in his 60s. He's in his 60s. You see? You can't live in delusion. Can't live in delusion. You have to pursue competition. Competition sharpens the sword. When we're training, what do I say a lot of times, guys? Iron sharpens iron. That's a Bible quote. The Bible says iron sharpens iron. It is true. When you train with stronger people, they sharpen you. They make you stronger. And you may feel that you're not strong, but compared to normal people, you're a Superman. You don't even know it. You're now so much more powerful than the normal person. You see that? Now, does the training those kind of things, does it do liberal progressive theory in terms of a society, weak families, childhood failure, competition avoidance, equality of outcomes? Everybody should get a trophy. Everybody should win. Everybody gets a gold medal. You don't have that in real combat. That's what I love about this type of real combat. There's a clear winner, clear loser. And if you lost, it's not the end of the world. You just go back and train harder. You fight smarter. It's not the end of the world. You can push through this loss. Right? Not everybody gets a gold medal. There's only one gold medal. That's it. Only one prize, one gold medal. Everybody else surrenders or loses. It's a totally different culture. What is this liberal progressive? Oh, make people feel good. Oh, don't hurt their feelings. We don't want anybody to get a silver medal. We don't want anybody to have bad feelings. Which then creates what? Socialism. Which then creates the idea that I can use centralized power to steal, force, use the government as a weapon to steal from people who are not scared of competing, and then steal from them and give to you. That's evil. That is wicked and evil. That is cowardly and evil. It's deplorable. But exactly what the Ivy Leagues and all these stupid colleges teach. Because we know all those professors, they are scared to be in the presence of real men and women. Scared. Who don't bow down to their stupid academic degrees. Shooting sports. Look at these women. Look at these women. You want to mess with these women? Do you want to mess with these women? Would you mess with these women? These are strong women. They're a different type of species. You're taught if you ski, you're strong. You're taught if you believe in yourself, you're strong. You're telling if you tell yourself affirmations every day, you're strong. No, you're deluding yourself. That's a strong woman. She's not scared. She's not scared of a tool. She can dominate creation. Anything that man creates, she can dominate. That's a strong woman. No archangel can come to them and say, oh, you know, those guns will really hurt you, girls. They're all professional competitive shooters. You know, those guns are really dangerous, and you know, you really have to hand them in. They're so dangerous. Good luck trying to tell it to these ladies. You're not going to get anywhere with them. They can control tremendous power. Tremendous power. And they can do it responsibly, technically, and powerfully. Have dominion over creation, ladies. Don't be jellyfish. Don't be wimps. Have dominion over creation. Accept your birthright as queen. Don't let Satan take it. They're normal women just like you and just like, did I almost say you and me? I didn't say that. You heard it. Skinny little girl. That's a dangerous woman. You better not mess with that woman. She's probably 100 pounds. But you better not mess with that woman. She's the real Charlie's Angels, folks. Not these stupid celebrities who pretend. These ladies are the real thing. And you can too. Chaniguk requires men and women to be the real thing. Look at that powerful woman. Where's she at? Oh. Look at that powerful woman. Look at that queen. Dang. Queen with an AR-15. You better not mess around. You see, folks, these people in the gun community are just like you and me. They have all the same fears as you. They have all the same insecurities and anxieties as you. They just have pushed through the fear. That's the only difference. That's the only difference. They're exactly the same as you. When your husband is behind a wall and then you come in the room and he goes, wah, and you go, ah, so she did it too. They're just like you. But they have chosen to accept their birthright. To have dominion over creation. That includes the archangel. So, is this picture politically correct? Who cares? It's hot. It's awesome. It's hot. It's powerful. It's powerful. Survival. This is one of the top bushcrafters in Europe. Survival Lily. I'm a subscriber. Amazing. Amazing young lady. She started her bushcraft adventure, you know, journey a couple years ago. She's become the number one in Europe. She hunts, she does all that. And she, guess what? Surprise, surprise, she's conservative. Isn't that a surprise that all these people who do this are more conservative? Isn't that a surprise? This culture builds reality. It builds getting out of fantasy. It builds build it yourself. Look at that. She built that whole super shelter herself. One girl. She's like in her 20s. She's an accountant. She's an accountant. I'm not joking. Now she quit her job as an accountant. She does this full time because she has hundreds of thousands of followers. She's like the Bear Grylls of Europe. She's huge. One small girl in the woods. Hunting community, girls in hunting community, demonized as being so. No, these women are powerful women. Why? These women have control over life and death. Do you see how important that is, folks? This is very important. The devil will always say, oh, you should not control the power over life and death. I should control it. Wrong. That's what he says. This is what all big governments say. You have to let us control life and death. You should not control that. That's what they say. It's the monopoly of murder and money. But when you are able to participate in the power and the right of dominion over creation and have responsible power over life and death, you're different, folks. Different person. You're someone now who has a totally different epigenetic reality. You are someone who has seen blood. You've touched it. You have worked with it in processing an animal. You are not scared of that. I don't know why women would be scared of it anyways. You have the monthly cycle anyways. Why so scared of blood? We're getting real. There are women who are marginalized in society. No mainstream media, no Hollywood stars promote these women, but thank God for the internet because they can promote themselves. They don't need the stupid mainstream media. They can have hundreds of thousands of followers cheering them on, saying, praise God for a lady like you who's not scared of life and death. Because when good people see weak women and men who can be easily scared, they know a tyrant and a predator will use that against them. That's why good people don't like seeing people being weak. They want them to be strong so that other predators can't kill them. They're just like you and me. All races, all creeds. Little, you know, young Asian girl, maybe Native American, hunting in Idaho. Surprise, surprise, they're conservative. Isn't that strange? See, people, and of course, you know, I have to end with fishing because Father loves fishing. Fishing is, you know, it's really interesting. Fishing is hunting. It's hunting fish. That's all you're doing. You're hunting fish. I don't know why they separate them like that. It's this, you're hunting fish. I mean, when you're fishing, you're hunting fish. So Father was not only a small game hunter and, you know, like that. He was hunted with shotguns, but he also hunted fish all his life. There is something very important. I've been learning all these out in these kind of sports, these kind of activities for life, folks. Learning to be comfortable in nature, debunking fantasy, learning about the natural world, learning that bears are not out to kill you. You just have to manage your food properly. They don't want to eat human flesh. They just want your peanut butter. Learning about reality, folks, not fantasy. Oh, if you walk into the woods, the bears will all eat you up. Yeah, if you spread peanut butter on you, they will. But if you don't do that and you manage your food properly, no bear will even come near you. But you are meant to be scared of the wilderness. the media and everybody else around you tries to scare you out of interacting with God's creation. Why? Because if you interact with God's creation through hunting, fishing, survival, bushcraft, outdoors, even martial arts, you're interacting, combat martial arts, you have to interact with people, which is God's creation too. You got to fight people, but they're your fighting partners. Look at what it did. When you do those things and you interact with people, what do? You actually start going into philosophy, folks. Do you know that when you go out under the stars and you look out at those huge stars and you say, wow, I am so small in all of this. That's philosophy. You're starting philosophy. Who am I? That is the main philosophical question of all the great philosophers. As soon as you get out into the natural world and get out from the icebox to the AC and all that, you start philosophizing. You start saying, wow, look at those. Those are planets billions of miles away. How vast this universe is. Wow, everything becomes so amazing. Poetry comes from that, folks. Poetry. Love songs, music, relationships come from that. Folks, what else comes? Theology. We start reflecting on the nature of God, on his great creation. Understand the painter by looking at the painting, studying the painting. The mind of God, the pursuit of all theology and philosophy. You see, when you take yourself out from the artificial synthetic GMO world and you go into non-GMO, you go into the wilderness, you go and connect with all these things, you are forced to, and you don't bring electronics, you don't bring all those videos, and you don't bring those things, or just shut them off. You have to look at the outdoors. It's snowing here. Oh, look at that. Look at that stream. Listen to the stream sound. Throw that line. Follow the crooks and crannies that are along the edge. Understand the animal you're trying to work with. Learn about medicinal plants. You start becoming real, folks. You're not in, oh, what did that sitcom play last night? Hey, what's the new video game? Boo! That's all fantasy land. What's the new Korean drama that came out? Oh, he's so hot. Boo! Boo! That's not real. That stuff is fake. That's how they steal your money. You can go out for free. You can have a million star hotel. I sleep under a 5 million star hotel. With an open tent. All I need is a piece of cloth. That's my tarp. You get in contact with God. Now, these things, do you think? These are activities that can perpetuate strong family bonding periods. Cooking around the campfire, cooking food for each other, learning skills together. Talking, whoa, we can talk. Whoa, instead of playing video games or text messaging, hey, we could talk. What a great idea. What a fantastic idea. I can see your face and talk to you, honey. What a great idea. What a great modern invention that must be, right? Strong families, childhood success, pursuit of competition, acceptance and equality. Sometimes little Billy Joe catches a fish and Jane doesn't catch a fish. Okay, you accept that inequality. The next day, Jane can catch a fish, Billy Joe may not catch a fish. Okay, these teach you these principles. Do they teach you these liberal, progressive, socialist, communist, weak families, breakdown relationships? No, all those activities foster relationships. They foster thinking deeply together. They foster deeper relationships instead of, oh, hey, how you doing? I'm fine. Okay, see you later. They foster deeper relationships, deeper levels of connecting, folks. Deeper levels. That's probably why the Lord of Second Advent was such an advocate of these type of arts. Whether it be the martial arts training for young people, whether it be shooting sports, hunting sports, fishing, all that. Maybe there's a reason. Maybe it wasn't just a hobby. Maybe it was a culture he was trying to teach us. Something that needs to be a part of our lives. What did Jesus say to that woman who said, "Blessed is the womb who bore you and the breast that nurtured you"? Jesus said, "Better is he or all who hear the word of God and practice it." You may hear me preaching about this today, but will you practice it? Will you get out of your fear and comfort zone and your Korean drama potato chip eating time, video game delusional fantasy land pink fairy time, and step into reality? Do you have the cojones to admit that you are scared and to step in with warriors? Do you know how to farm, Father asked? That was a great transition. Man, that was a good transition right there. That was very good. I know how to farm. Let's read together. I must teach that to you. The members of the Vicar Church should know how to do three things: how to farm, how to hunt, and how to fish. Therefore, even if you go alone to a village in Africa, it should only take you a week to establish a basis for you to live by feeding the village people. There's tons of intentions. Anyways, let's finish up with 1406. Are you not people of the completed Testament age? You are Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden created by God. Have this concept in your mind that you are warriors who can fight and defeat Satan and bring the families in the satanic world over to God's side on the final battlefield of this global war. That's it, folks. Cultivate the kingdom. We're already doing it with the young people. They're ahead of you, folks. Now I know some of the ladies. Now some of our more senior ladies are actually, you're amazing. Tammy, who was it? Tammy, Anna, who was a Sister Warren? Where are you guys? I give you guys credit, man. They're in their 40s or 50s or whatever. Some of them in the 60s. Who's in the 60s? Huh? Who trained with us? They're not telling. Why are you white dopey? Who cares? Okay. Anyways, they won't tell. They're in that age group and they are challenging their fears. I know they're scared. I'm not going to make them fight young people, but they're at least getting out of their comfort zone. Martha, she joined us too. Can you believe Martha joined us too? Can you believe it? Wow. You see that? You're stepping in. You're unlocking your epigenetics. You're facing your fears. Something you never believed you could do. You're trying. That is love. You're doing it not for yourself. You're doing it for the King of Kings to make Father happy. You're doing it, and you get all the benefits of being healthier and stronger and fitter and more beautiful. So you get all those benefits. But your motivation is to bring him joy, and that's why you're beautiful. You can be 68 years old. Who is 68 years old here, lady? Okay. But you're still beautiful because your motivation, your purpose of putting yourself through that is to bring Christ's joy. That's beauty. That's beauty in a bride. That's beauty. All right, SOS, come on up. Folks, it's all about love in the end. When we fight, it's for love. It's for love. Let's all rise up and give some glory to the King. And also, let's offer these songs. Joy in our hearts. Glory to the King of Kings. He makes us king and queen.
Who is God and comes, the spices yield the rain. Thank you, everyone. We'd like to now take this time to go into the garden and worship our Father together. Glory to our God together, everyone. Let's sing Our God. We got a new song to play for you all today. You probably don't know it, so feel free to sit down or join in if you feel inspired. But this song, I really felt inspired to share it, and it's called Thy Will by Hillary Scott. And I feel like it's really like in troubling times, you know, if you're like really down, like the devil is really pushing on you and everything just seems down and you can't even like seem to find God. And then if you take that time, at that time, if you just submit yourself completely to God, he will answer you and he will bring his will, and through you, he'll be able to work his will and bring his kingdom through you. So that's what this song is to me about. So feel free to join along or just sit and enjoy it. We hope you enjoy it.
I'm so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear, so I followed through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't wanna think, I may never understand that my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I've got is hurt and these four words. Thy will be done, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I know this don't feel good right now, and I know you think of things I could never think about. It's hard to count it all as joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God and I am not. So I
승리! 억만세! 만왕 전진 장모님 3대 왕권! 억만세! 천의국 창건! 억만세! 아주 hug your neighbor! God bless this place! Woo!